because you saw your mom, or you actually was struggling?
Chill out.
His mom has a crush on Veradini.
You gonna say that on the internet, bro?
No, even like in the beginning, I felt like that. I was like, oh,
what are we doing?
Yo, why do we have a podcast? Why don't we just be playing tennis?
Speaking of sweatbands, tennis players, please, like when you finish playing a match or you finish practicing, just take the wristband off. Like, don't be in Chipotle after the match eating your chicken.
All right, man.
Why are you smiling, brother?
I guess I have to do now. I've been bored as... I'm not going to say that word. I'm not going to watch.
What's up, everybody? Welcome to another episode of the Changeover Podcast. If this is your first time, my name is Jody. This is Justin. This is Evan. And we are the Changeover Podcast. We're aware that we have a few new subscribers to the channel. So welcome. Hopefully you guys enjoy our content. Thanks for supporting us so far. And one thing you should know about us three is that we are liars. Because 2 weeks ago we said that we're going to have a few pros from the Miami Open.
We had one.
And we've had one. And now we're back, just the three of us, sitting on this couch like 2 weeks ago, here to talk about the Miami Open. So, Evan didn't go to any of the matches.
Yeah, so I was practicing.
So, Justin, since you weren't practicing, why don't you talk to us a little bit about the Miami Open, if you have any thoughts on the matches or the tournament or whatever, because I have a few takeaways myself and I have a few opinions on it, but go ahead.
For me... Yeah, it was nice. I enjoyed my time on the outside courts much more than I did on the stadium court. I think the stadium court is like a mix between a tennis stadium and a football stadium.
Which match did you watch on the stadium?
We saw Murray Berrettini. That was nice to see Murray win there. I think maybe it's supposed to be his last year playing on the tour. But yeah, the vibes in the center court are not great, in my opinion. But when we went and watched...
Compared to the outside courts, at least.
Yeah, when I went to watch matches on court one or like Butch Olds, you feel close to the court. The energy is pretty high. You had, at least when we were watching matches, we saw quite a few South Americans. And when those guys are playing, I feel like Miami is South America. So there's a lot of chanting, a lot of singing, and it's just good energy. So yeah, for me, I think that they do a really good job in the outer courts. And I enjoyed that part of the experience quite a bit. And then tennis-wise, you just see very clearly that how important a player's identity is. So watching, for example, Berrettini play, you see very clearly what he's trying to do. He's using his slice to get his forehand, using his serve to get his forehand. And it's obvious. You see Casper Ruud trying to get to the forehand setup position, like control points that way. He's not doing much with the backhand in terms of like changing directions. Most of the time he's playing cross until he gets a chance to hurt you with the forehand. Who else did we watch? Chris Eubanks. He seemed to enjoy the forehand inside in when he was attacking. And you saw that even though in some big moments where Dan Evans was passing well with the running forehand, he stuck to what was working best for him. Because a few times he tried to go to the inside out and saw the big moments, and he... For whatever reason, he seems less comfortable hitting that shot. I don't know if that's just that day or if it's his game. And he kind of overcooked some or looked a little bit hesitant on some of those. But in big, big moments, he went to his inside and forehand, and it paid off. Saved a crazy match point there too, which was also fun to be a part of that atmosphere. But yeah, for me, takeaways are great outside court for atmosphere. And then just watching the players play, I really felt like the identities were very clear.
Yeah. I agree. I mean, I think the cool thing about stadium court is that, like, it's the show court. So there's production. There's, like, the screen and the commercials and all this stuff, the songs, music playing, that sort of stuff. And the outside courts, maybe not the same, but, like, because it rained for a few days, you had so many ridiculous matches on the outside courts. Like, we sat on court one for, like, two and a half matches. Mm-hmm. Like, there was a match before Eubanks. I can't remember who it was. Oh, it's Casper Ruud. We watched Casper Ruud, and then right after Casper Ruud, Eubanks,
and then Morphy's versus Jordan Thompson.
Yeah. And I think, and that wasn't even, and for us, like, it was ridiculous to see the match point and that sort of stuff, like, yeah. Cheering and supporting was fun, but then the next day we weren't there for the South American matches where, like, well, we saw a little bit of Jari on one of the other courts, but, like, the, what was it, on Bush Halls with Jerry.
Jerry versus Wild from Brazil. Yeah, exactly. That was crazy.
So those matches. But I agree, like, it's the South American fans make Miami.
And even, like, the last round of qualies, we watched Diego Schwartzman playing, and there were people out, like, yeah, full stands on court, whatever, 5, 6, whatever that was. So, yeah, that's cool to see.
I'm curious how the different Masters are, like, the other ones, like, how the crowds are, those ones. Like, I'm sure in Europe and these kind of places, they love tennis, but, like, to me, the best fans that I see is the Chile fans. Like, yeah, they come out in numbers, jerseys, they're singing Chichi Chile. Like, yeah, they're just gonna, like,
yeah, I don't know. I feel like every tournament has, like, its identity. Same way, like, I feel like if you go to Monte Carlo, it's gonna be proper, and you have to kind of be kind of in your. It's closer to, like, probably Indian Wells. You know what I mean? It's like it looks like an older crowd. Not as rowdy. So for me, like, watch this in person and watching on TV, being at Indian Wells is a lot less rowdy than it is in Miami. And I think that's just to do with the crowd. Just the actual people who go to the event are just different kinds of people. And I guess that makes the tour cool too, because different parts of the world, different cities have different cultures and different, I guess, populations. So yeah, I think just depending on geography, simple, you're just going to get different kinds of people.
You think Indian Wells should be after Miami?
For the reason
that, like, I believe the conditions to play in Miami are a lot tougher to play than Indian Wells.
So early in the year.
Just, like, switch 2 weeks before, yeah, to switch them, because, like, maybe the players have a little bit more time to prepare for Miami and then go to Indian Wells than rather than play Indian Wells and then get straight to Miami. You know? Like, we saw people, like, fainting and, like, struggling
physically. Their team actually kind of passed out.
Yeah. That would have been madness in the stadium if that happened. But, like, just...
Because he saw your mom when he actually was struggling.
Chill out.
His mom has a crush on Berrettini.
You're going to say that on the internet?
Bro, yeah, who cares? His mom has a crush on Berrettini, so...
when I care.
But, so yeah, when he got a lost balance, we made a joke that it's because I got with her in the stand.
I think... it makes sense the way you're saying it. I mean,
it's easier to go from humid to nice than nice to humid.
Yeah, exactly.
Exactly.
Yeah, I don't have any other...
Nothing to add?
If it worked out logistically, I think that'd be better for the players.
I don't know how the business works, but I feel like just...
Yeah, I just don't know.
Just the health-wise. But
that's the first time I've seen that, though. I've never seen players painting at Miami Open. That's
yeah, same. I also don't think it was crazy hot. Like, it was definitely humid, but, like, compared to Miami in the summer.
Yeah, you know, sure, there's other tournaments. Like, I heard Atlanta's so hot than the ATP there. Yeah, I don't know. It's weird that people are...
Like, for sure, the conditions in Australia at the beginning of the year must be tougher than how it was this week in Miami. Yeah. I didn't play either of them. But I would assume. But another highlight of our week was that we had the podcast with Sloane. So we had a few potential others lined up, but Sloane was the only one we actually managed to get in because of scheduling. So big shout out to Sloane for linking up with us and allowing us to record with her. I thought that the episode was very good. I'm assuming that you guys think the same way based on the feedback that we got on the episode. But what kind of happened was that we got to spend pretty much 2 days with her, like a little birthday celebration with her and I guess her close ones, like her team. And then the next day we got to set up the podcast at the hotel that they were staying at and whatnot. And it was just kind of cool to see what a big player kind of lives like how she interacted with her team. The people that make her, I guess, tick, like help her to perform on the court. So we got to see that and maybe not necessarily live it, but like see it for 2 days. So it was pretty cool.
See the type of people she had on her team, what everyone did and stuff.
Exactly. So, and then obviously in the episode itself, there was some interesting takeaways. So the first one was about her not taking tennis too seriously. So... yeah, like, obviously she's had criticism in the past about, you know, if she likes tennis or not and blah, 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 blah. But, I mean, she was pretty clear that there are days just like everyone else that is challenging or whatever. But overall, like since she was young, it seems like it was pretty easy going for her, and that probably helps her perform on the court. You know what I mean?
Yeah, and I think it's kind of unfair, in my opinion, how commentators or people on Twitter or whoever, they try to define for you what should be important in your life for you, when it's your life. If she's like she said, like it was never really a goal for anyone in the world or to like win slams. She happened to win a slam, become number three in the world, and find another slam. And it sounded to me like the whole journey was kind of like, yeah, I'll try the sport. Yeah, I'm pretty good. Like, why not? Like, you know? So if she's happy being, I don't know, top 40, top 20, and making good money and traveling the world and playing a sport that she likes, and her goal is not to be the Novak Djokovic of women's tennis, then why is that a crime? Like,
it's funny because like on one of the clips he posted on Instagram, it was the one of you making a joke about not being able to eat the night before your first future final that you won. Yeah. And someone commented under saying, like, not you comparing winning a futures to a grand slam.
Didn't really understand what I was trying to say.
Yeah, but like also it's like on obviously the pressure is going to be more like at a slam, you know what I mean? But like it also depends
I think everything is relative.
I was about to say it depends on what you value, you know what I mean? Like if you want it so bad for yourself, then it's going to be tough, you know?
Yeah, but like if I was, I don't know, 30 in the world, then I would look at a futures final like whatever.
Yeah.
But up to that point in my life, I had never probably passed the quarters in the future.
Exactly.
So it's like, for me, it's a huge deal.
And that's all we can do as the podcast host is like, we're trying to learn from the guests. Obviously, we're making the progress, we're trying to learn, but like, we do this too, you know what I mean? And I mean, you mustn't forget it. So, So anyway, we can go on to the next one. Oh, I guess this kind of ties into it. It's about her talking about the French Open. So she was saying that how the French Open is the slam she likes the most and it's the one she wanted to win the most. But then when talking about losing in the final, obviously she said it hurt her and whatnot, but she was like, you know, it was Halep's time. Like, it was her time to win. And it seemed like she, I don't know if move on is the right word, but like...
Letting go.
Let go, yeah, exactly. Because like, I don't know if... Like, we go back to if she really wants it and really tried, and she wants the slam so bad, the French Open, and then she gets there and fails in a final. Who knows, like, if it affects her more, if she takes it seriously and puts pressure on herself, and who knows how her performance is. It's like, I can think of myself, for example, up to this morning, my coach was telling me, like, whenever practice is light and I'm making jokes and I'm, like, messing around, competing, whatever, the quality of my practice is a lot better and the quality of my tennis is a lot better. But the heavier it becomes and the more like I'm trying to fix something, I'm trying to improve, like when I really focus and do that, like the performance of my practice and my improvement actually goes down.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And so it almost distracts you from the actual work you're doing sometimes, and it helps, you know?
And she spoke to it. She mentioned that going into the US Open that she had no pressure. Every win was like icing on the cake, and she made it probably sound lighter than it was. I can imagine the night before at the final that she's not just like, oh, it's going to be fun. But I'm sure that if she had lost that final, it would have been like, this is a great start to my comeback from injury. And then going from then becoming a Grand Slam champion and then being in the final again, probably she's seeing it different. Maybe now she feels like I'm supposed to win these kind of matches now. And it's not all upside anymore. Maybe she feels a bit more like there's a different kind of pressure on the match. So I think it's human. I think it makes sense. But you have to, probably the best players, either they deal with that very well or they find a way to trick themselves or to keep themselves in a certain mind state that allows them to deal with those pressures well. Like, I was listening on a podcast today, JJ Redick, he was on like on Schultz's podcast, like a comedy podcast, and they were talking about, like, he used to set all these goals, and Coach K at Duke kind of used to ask him, what have you done over this period of time that you feel like you deserve to achieve these goals? Because I think he was into, like, frat life and getting drunk and all this stuff, and he wasn't actually maximizing his potential. And he said, from that summer on, he never set a goal again in his life. All of his goals then were all about the input, things that he could control. I thought that was pretty interesting. He ended up having a pretty cool NBA career for his height and his size and what he could do. And I think it's another way to look at, I guess, expectations and achieving things.
I feel like goal setting is so interesting because, like, I've seen, who was it? Someone shared recently on Instagram that they wrote goals down. Maybe it's Quinn. I think Ethan Quinn shared that he wrote goals down about, like, performance goals or whatever. And I did that last year, like ranking goals. Like, this is where I want to be by this date. This amount of points is what I need to get there, blah, 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 blah. And then a few months through, I randomly, like, I hadn't looked at it for a little bit. And then randomly, I looked back at it, and I was like, oh, my God, like, this is, I'm never going
to
get here.
Yeah, she's demotivated you.
Yeah.
I remember that's when you started to doubt playing singles and all this stuff.
Yeah, I was thrown, like, completely thrown by it. So I think it just depends on the personality. Like, so if, again, going back to the mood, so, like, for Sloane, right, people think, she, like, the way she talks about it is so easy. You know, it's so light and blah, blah, blah. I feel like I'm similar in the sense that maybe I don't talk about it that easily, and maybe that's part of the reason that holds me back. So, for example, in the last 2 weeks, I've been here training, week and a half I've been training. I've done a million, thousand, bazillion cross-court forehands.
It's not a real job.
Trying hard. I'm aware. But I'm trying hard, like, to improve in this area. You know, it's an area that I'm already good at, but, like, I feel like this is a strength of mine, so I want to, like, really have it, like, nailed home. But I was trying to improve it, and maybe my energy was too serious a lot of the time. And today I was reflecting on it in the middle of practice, and I feel like for the last week and a half, I haven't been hitting cross-court forehands.
Mm-hmm.
So it's so interesting. It's all I've been doing every day. I've done so many reps of it, but I don't feel like I've been doing it at all because the mentality was wrong. And wrong not doesn't mean that...
You say you feel it's doing it. You feel like the way it feels, or you're saying that you don't feel like you spend enough time doing it? What are you saying?
Correct. I feel like I've spent zero time doing it, and it's all I've been doing every day in practice.
That's odd.
You know what I mean? that's because like, my... Hey. I'm just saying, like,
you got me lost over here.
Yeah, it's because my mentality was wrong to it. So, like, I feel like I haven't actually improved it at all. Like, I feel like I haven't spent time doing it when that's all I've been doing. You know what I mean? When I say that my mentality was wrong, like, it was wrong for me. Maybe if you have the exact same mentality that I had today, had last week and a half, you feel great about your training, your block. You know what I mean? So I think of Sloane in that way. Like, maybe if Sloane takes it too seriously, she's not going to feel prepared, and maybe she's not going to feel confident. I don't know. I don't want to speak for her, but, like, I'm saying that I
can... It's the same thing with identity. Like, you have to know what... Well, first, who you are, and then from knowing who you are, you kind of figure out what works for you and what doesn't. And, yeah, I think maybe for me too, like, when he said it, kind of resonated with me that he doesn't write down outcome goals anymore. He just writes down the inputs. Maybe that was something that might work for me, because I think recently, in the recent times when I've tried to set these pretty high goals, I don't think I felt super stressed or anything like that, but just having that expectation in my mind, I don't think I performed as well. So maybe if I could just focus on things that I can actually control, and then I kind of live with the result, maybe that's going to help me perform better. And that might be different for Evan, different for you. So, yeah, I think it's just interesting to see how people operate. One thing that surprised me about the episode 2 was she talked about being at home watching ESPN while the tournament was going on, and, like,
seeing.
I think if I was in a situation, I would have no ESPN on. I wouldn't want to see any of that.
I spent, Reece, I'm sorry, last year, was it last year?
You cover your stomach, dog. You look like you're trying to wear a crop top out there.
I'm sorry, my brother. last year, I spent a day at the Palace training ground.
Yeah.
And I was in the lunchroom at the end of the day, and I didn't really interact with any of the players. It's not my place. I was just there. I was work experience for the day. And I just remember seeing that the TV was on in the lunchroom, two TVs on with, like, one of the, I don't know, Sky Sports, or one of these, like...
ESPN for...
You know what I mean? Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And they, like, every now and again, someone walking out or something would take a look, and that sort of stuff. Like, I feel like a lot of these people do that. Like, they know what's going on. You know, maybe some of them try to avoid it, but, like, they know what's going on.
You hear about, like, LeBron James saying in the playoffs he goes 0-30, like, no Instagram, like, no TV.
You ever done it on Instagram?
Did you?
For other reasons.
Did you delete your Instagram? You didn't have one for a while, right?
Yeah, that was like probably back in 20. That was what I, yeah.
I've done it every now and again.
But I haven't done it in a long time. That was,
I like it. I can't really do it now.
I've never done it.
Well, you can't do it now either because you're trying to build something. But,
I'll do it now.
But I just feel that it's odd that she would be like welcoming in that outside talk, because I think the game is.
But if it's fresh, not that serious, like she doesn't.
No, I know, but that's what I found strange. That's what I found interesting, that she was so open to watching that stuff. Because for me, generally speaking, like there's enough pressure that I put on myself that I wouldn't enjoy hearing McEnroe and whoever talking about who should win tomorrow and then seeing the money and all this stuff. I feel like I would just rather keep it light with me and my team and just focus on playing tennis. And then maybe after, we can look at all that stuff. But
I guess that's the last little thing we should talk about, like the team also. So like, when we walked in, Sloane was having lunch that was prepared for her. And not to give too much away about her, like how she lives her life. But I just, for the people who think that she's just coasting, you know, like that she's not taking it seriously and she doesn't love the game or whatever. Like that day, I'm assuming that she woke up, ate breakfast, went to the courts, trained, got back. She was having lunch. Then she helped us out for like, maybe we're there for like what, hour and a half, 2 hours. At the end, what was she doing before we left?
She was signing a bunch of stuff.
She signed like a million autographs for people, like for, I don't know what it was for, but she was doing stuff. And the conversations that they were having was like, it was, the day was going on, you know, it wasn't like the day was over. Mm-hmm. And I don't know, she had a match the next day, so maybe she had to do some work on her body with physio, whatever. So it's like, yeah, it's cool that she has a team around her that's helping her do it, but the day is long, you know what I mean? It's still not, it's a work week, you know?
Mm-hmm.
So for those who think that she's just coasting or whatever, like we got to see firsthand that like her day is pretty full. And I guess that's one of the things that she valued, because we talked about it and like once or twice, three times, maybe she brought it up in the episode about business, like about making money and that sort of stuff. And maybe that's something that she values. So like, you can tell that she's aware and tries to, you know, spend time on that sort of stuff, whether that's her own personal stuff or obligations to her sponsors or whatever the case may be. So
yeah, she gave us like two and a half hours of her time and then shot extra clips with like extra short stories for us to share it. And yeah, super helpful. So just thanks to Sloane for doing that with us, for us, and hopefully we can keep growing and we do it again.
Yeah,
down the line.
Shout out to Sloane. So this part, the next topic is, we have a friend from Texas that we spoke to on FaceTime or Instagram the other day. Justin and I spoke to him. You weren't here. And I don't think he knows I'm going to talk about this, but he said something to me about, he said he was surprised that we're still doing it now, that we're still doing the podcast now a year in. And he also said he's surprised that not only of the persistency, but like of how well we do it, like how thorough, I guess. He didn't use the word thorough, but he was like, he didn't expect us to get the right equipment and all this stuff. And I find that to be surprising to hear that, because, okay, if you look at our, compared to the goals that we want to achieve in our tennis career, maybe we're not there yet. But if you look at the approach that we've made since he's known us, or since anyone has known us, you can't fault us for how hard we try. The attitude we have, the not only the amount of time that we put in, but like the thought process behind putting it in, like working smart and that sort of stuff. So it was surprising that we, to hear that we would be doubted in the way that if we put that energy into tennis, why wouldn't we put that energy into anything else that we do in our lives? So, and I feel like this process in the podcast is very similar to our tennis career in a sense that, so I believe in the podcast. I believe that we're learning. I believe that we're improving. I believe that it has a lot of potential. And I believe that we're just figuring out how to get to where we want to get to. Like, we haven't actually sat down and said what our definite goals are. You know what I mean? But like, I just find it surprising to hear that the expectation is that we wouldn't do it seriously, that we would do it for a few weeks and give up and that sort of stuff. It's like,
yeah,
you know.
But I'm not sure if how directed it was personally at us.
I don't know.
I better say like it could have been more of like a general statement, because I feel like what we are doing is like sort of out of the box for tennis players. Like, you don't want to be that guy like with a podcast or like or like tennis YouTubers, like you don't want to be that guy with the
podcast guy.
Yeah,
it's my dog podcast.
You don't want to be that guy with the camera out all the time, or like, especially in the beginning when we first started, it was like, I don't know, people looking at you like, or asking questions about the podcast, but not in like a supportive way, but like in a, why are you doing it? Or like, what do you think is going to happen from it? So I can see why a lot of people would be turned off by that and why they would be deterred by that. And I think it's completely normal that if you do it for a bit and you don't get the validation or the, let's say, monetary success that you are looking for, then it makes sense why a lot of people would stop.
Yeah, but that's what I'm saying. Like, it's surprising that that's how they feel about us, because that's our tennis career. You know, like, we've been trying now for, what, for me personally, since 2017, 18, around this, when I started my, you know, obviously I've transitioned to now focusing on mostly doubles, but, like, it's been a lot of years of probably outside judgment, being like, why is he still playing? Like, why is this person playing? He's getting into the mid-20s. Now he's getting into the upper-20s. Like, you know what I mean? And I feel like this is the same, and it's a brand new project with the podcast, and I don't think we would have taken the time to do something. Like you said, we would be judged at the beginning of the process, you know?
So even, like, in the beginning, I felt like that. I was like, oh,
what are we doing?
Yo, why do we have a podcast? Shouldn't we just be playing tennis?
Yeah.
But yeah, I just agree with Justin on that part. I'm sure even if we felt that, or me, I don't want to speak for you guys.
Oh, me too, for sure.
Yeah, in the beginning, I'm sure other people feel that even more, like, judge that even more, so.
But I never, I definitely felt it like it was not common, but what I didn't feel was, like, I didn't feel one foot in, one foot out. I felt like all I've done since college was play tennis. That's my job, play tennis. And now I'm taking on another project, like, it's a part of my career now, and I'm going to do this really hard. You know, like, I didn't feel like I was just going to, oh, I'll just see how it goes. And then, you know, like, I thought that it's a serious thing. It's a time-consuming thing. And I believe that if we do it well, then we could be successful and it can actually help us. Like, the part of the reason why we do it is, you know, on one hand, we learn from other players and we get to market each other and the other players and that sort of stuff. But then also, hopefully, if it's a business that's flourishing, it can help us support our careers until we get to the income that would be able to support us from the tennis, you know what I mean?
Yeah, so. And I think a lot of times when people...
D was not watching this, by the way. There's 0% chance D was watching this episode. D, you better watch this.
But I think a lot of times when people look out at other people and go like, why is he doing that? Why is he still doing that? I think sometimes it's like... they're talking about their own insecurities. Like, they wouldn't feel comfortable stepping out of the box and doing something different. And they wouldn't feel comfortable, I guess, risking
man throwing shots.
No, but it's real. Because, like, what do you care if I try to do something different? Or if I like to play tennis and I'm able to play tennis and I want to pursue my dream for as long as I possibly can? What do you care? Like, yeah, why would you waste your time thinking about me or Jody or Evan and what they should be doing in your mind when it's my life? Like, if I have the ability to pursue a dream and I like it and I want to do it, I'm going to do it. And I'm not going to let someone I don't barely know tell me that, oh, you're so dumb. You know what I mean? Like, it's, for me, that's a waste of my energy and my, yeah.
You know what's cool about
time?
Sorry, you want to say something?
I was just going to say, I think I'm guilty of that too, because, like, I mean, the most common one would be like an influencer on something on Instagram. Okay. And they post something that's influencer-like, but they don't have a lot of followers. Yeah. And you see, you're like, what are they doing? But then everyone starts out like that.
Yeah.
And you don't see the value in it until
it's
a lot.
It's funny until it's cool.
Yeah. Exactly.
And we, like, maybe less now, but at the beginning, 100% I felt that way. Like, I did not want to be, like, it still makes me feel weird when someone sees me coming in and they're like, oh, it's the podcast guys, or oh, it's the changeover guys.
It's like a fun, like, in a mocking way, kind of.
Kind of, yeah, but they're not going to be mocking when we have, like, a lot of success, you know what I mean? But I what I was going to say a second ago was, like, okay, if we compare ourselves to the other YouTubers, even though they're not in the exact same industry, they don't do podcasts per se, but they do, I know, like Simon and Karu and these other guys that have all these subscribers on YouTube. It's easy to get demotivated seeing that our success is not as similar to theirs in the journey. but also like
it's also like time in too, like
yeah. But what I was about to say is that we can sit here now and maybe it's just the three of us on this episode, but I can guarantee maybe at minimum it's going to be 400 500 people who come here and sit down and listen to us talk for a little bit. Like, how often can we sit here and like think, you know, 500 people are coming to listen to us talk for an hour on the couch. Sit.
Somebody actually cares, bro. Like, we're at Miami Open and some kid, a guy named Diego, I don't know.
Shout out.
I don't know your last name. And probably won't recognize if you see you again. But he came up to us and was like, you the podcast guys? And I was like, yeah, I took a picture with him. Some other people came up to us too. So that's, we're not superstars at podcasting, but it's cool that somebody cares and likes to listen to us speak. So yeah. I think. And I'm not a broadcaster anyway. I stutter when I talk. Like, if you can sit and listen to this, then yeah, I appreciate you.
Yeah.
It can't be the best experience.
Like, I was going to say, like, we haven't reached anywhere close to our goals yet. Like, we haven't really, like, fully, you know, determined our goals, but I just know that we have thoughts of being very successful and whatever. But, like, we're still lucky to have, like, what, 1,000 people on YouTube, a couple thousand on Instagram interested in our journey and our project and that sort of stuff. So, yeah, thanks to those people. Again.
I think if we were all top 20 in the world and we had those numbers, then we could be like, what are we doing? When we came into this, we're kind of no names in terms of like cachet for the tennis world. So I think we've been doing pretty well and I've been enjoying the process. So like,
and like,
I would keep doing it.
How much better is the Sloane episode than like
Oscar's back in the day?
Yeah, no offense to Oscar, but like, when we did Oscar's episode, the cameras died like 2 times.
Recorded half of it on my phone.
When we did Zeke's episode in Mexico, literally we started recording after like 10 minutes, cameras died, overheating in the place. I don't know if you guys saw the episode. We have like
pink wall in the back.
There's a wall in the back. We have like sweatbands on, like sweat like crazy because we're staying at the cheapest Airbnb. There's no AC in the room. Like horrible, horrible. We don't know how to. We still don't know how to work the cameras, by the way. Like, half the stuff that we have now is broken. Like, we're replacing stuff. The light thing is broken. One of these stands are broken. This couch is broken. Like, but we're making it work. So,
speaking of sweatbands, tennis players, please, like, when you finish playing a match or you finish practicing, just take the wristband off. Like, don't be in Chipotle after the match eating your chicken, your barbecue bowl with your guac, with a Nike wristband on, dog. Like, let it go. Like, it's okay. There's on-court and off-court attire, and you don't wear wristbands in the real world.
So what, the shoes, the tennis shoes.
Yeah, yeah. And, like, untie them. Like, have a little bit of relax.
Let them breathe.
So running shoes on some slides, something.
Okay, last little half serious topic. So LeBron and JJ Redick started their podcast last week, and there was like kind of a joke about LeBron, like when I think JJ Redick asked him, what does discipline mean to him? And he said that you have to sacrifice loved ones for a long period of time.
Been doing that.
That sounds so serious. You know, it sounds like the man is, you know what I mean? Anyway, but Justin,
yeah,
why don't you explain, I guess, how often you get to go home, how often you get to spend time with your family, and why something like this from LeBron resonates with you?
Yeah, so when I was, I want to say 12 years old, I was lucky enough that my family could afford that I would go to Tennis Academy. And my mother, my brother and sister, like, we all went to Everett. Well, I went to Everett and they went to a regular school in Boga. I did that for one semester, and then from I was 13 until I was 17, I was the only one doing it. I was by myself. They went back home, and I just was living at the academy. But like,
I didn't know you trained at Everett.
Yeah, I was there for 2 years.
Oh, really?
Just what, you about to turn up? You think that's the worst?
Oh, yeah. So
you about to ship out overseas?
Yeah. And then the coach I was working with at Everett left. He was from Holland, and yeah, he was leaving. And at the time, the boys group wasn't that good at Everett anymore. So we decided that I would go with him back to Holland, and I worked with him for 2 more years until I went to school at USF. And I think since I was 12 years old, I probably spent between 2 and maybe 6 weeks of the year at home with my family. So like, I don't see my mother, father, brother, sister that much. And now my sister works in the US at the time. My brother was working and doing school in Georgia. So I would, I don't see my family often, and it's a sacrifice I'm happy to make, because this has been my dream since I was 6 years old. So I've been blessed enough to be able to pursue that, and to have the support a supporting family who wants to help me make that dream a reality. Yeah, since then too. So that I went to school, and I was playing pro events in the summers. So yeah, since I was 12, I probably spent probably less than, for sure, less than 10% of the year at home with my family. Easy. Like, I'm just normal at this point.
And I'm the same way. Like, I'm the same way, not from that young, maybe from about 16, I think, is when I left home. And I was the same way. But even for Evan's perspective, like, I don't want to speak for you and your situation, but his family has made sacrifices. But then, like, how many weeks out of the year would you say that you're on the road at tournaments, you think?
26, 27.
At least 26. And, like, it's not one of those things where you're gone for a few days, back for a few days. Like, you're gone for, like, probably, if you're gone for a block, you're gone for 2 to 5 weeks at a time and that sort of stuff. So, like, even for someone who, like, Evan was fortunate enough to stay with your family, you still spent so much time away. You know what I mean?
Yeah. And my dad still has a job in Delaware, so, like, I don't see him that much.
Yeah.
But, yeah, I've been with my mother a lot. But, yeah, just...
Shout out,
Julie. but, yeah, just traveling and stuff. I mean...
It's just an interesting, like part of the definition that I didn't think about it. You know, like, when I was thinking about discipline, I'm thinking about doing the things necessary to be successful and
stretching after you practice or stuff like that.
And cutting out the things that are going to stand in your way. And, like, that's very surface level of it. But then when you go back to other things like this, it's
you miss a lot. Like,
yeah.
How often have you had a birthday at home?
Yo, I woke up.
You ever had a birthday party?
Birthday party, I might have been in grade 4.
Last year, on my birthday, I woke up. Uncle Mark, if you're watching this, thank you, by the way. But I woke up in San Diego last year, sleeping on the air mattress, but the air mattress deflated to the floor. So when I woke up on my birthday, I was sleeping on the floor, like in San Diego.
We got killed in doubles by Segerman and another guy.
I was like, this is a horrid birthday, bro.
This is changeover lore. Exclusive. Changeover lore.
And I woke up on the floor at a 15K at 28. I was like, this is not the direction that I thought my tennis career was going to go, you know?
Why are you always sleeping on the floor?
What do you mean? When last did I sleep on the floor?
Because it'll be a good story to tell one day.
You think that's what it was?
It'll be sick in your documentary.
You think I knew the air mattress was going to deflate to the floor?
You should document this moment. Just take a selfie in this moment. So we could put them up later.
No, I was too busy, like, cracking
when you stand at the Ritz-Carlton at some point, you'd be like, you know, you sleep on the floor at tournaments.
No, when the podcast is successful, we'll come up on the tennis career and that sort of stuff. That leads into the next question. Sebastian asks, when did you start to feel like a pro? It wasn't in San Diego last year, buddy. Could tell that much.
I mean...
Start feeling like a pro.
Okay, I think it's a funny question. Like, there are weeks there are weeks in the year that you feel like, okay, I'm doing the thing that I dreamed about doing. Like I had a few weeks, like, Pan Am Games.
Not doing the thing, but, like, living the life.
Right? Yeah.
Like, you do the thing that you dream about doing every day.
In the right way, you're right. Like, if it feels like a professional event, like, I'm being taken care of as a professional athlete. People are here to watch this thing that I'm doing. The courts are nice. I'm treated well. And I'm able to express myself on the court and do the thing that I love to do. And
it's like you're and somebody cares too much.
Yeah. And somebody cares, you know? So, like, you definitely have weeks of that. And then you have other weeks where you're in Cancun or Timbuktu somewhere.
I'll say Cancun. That's where you had your first title, dog. You have to show some respect.
All right. Shout out to Cancun. But it's not the ATP talk. You know what I mean? Like, it's not. So, yeah, there's times where you feel like the work that you put in and the sacrifices that you make, sacrificing your family, that it's worth it. There are those times, and the other times where you're you just feel like you're still sacrificing. Like, this week is another sacrifice until I get to where I want to be.
Hey, Casper Ruud felt like he was sacrificing in Miami. You get that one or no?
Why, because of the tent?
Yeah. So I guess he didn't know.
No.
I'll tell the Mirza Basic story again. I played a challenge in Irving, Texas. And for me, it was like the biggest tournament I ever played. And I was playing against Mirza Basic, and the court was a little bit slanted, and we were shaking hands at the end of the match after he chopped me, and he was like furious. He was like, man, this court is so bad. This is a horrible court. And I was like, dog, I'm going to Cancun next week. I don't want to hear the court's a little bit slanted. It's windy. Like, this tournament is sick. We have ball kids.
Like, to be fair, like we said in the beginning, everything is relative. So if you spend 20 weeks of the year at very nice tournaments and you go to one where you're all of a sudden the water's not cold, you're like, what is this? You know what I mean? That makes sense to me as well.
I feel it forever a little bit because, like, growing up, you go to UCLA. The treatment at UCLA is very nice. You love California. California is very nice. And then you have to go to places like at the beginning of your career to not the nicest places. And it's not necessarily what you're used to, you know? So I can see why it's tough for some of the people, like, to go to these places if you're not used to it. You're not accustomed to it, you know? But then, I don't know, like, Holt, I guess, was one of the guys who did that. But then he said that once he got on the court, he felt comfortable. You know, it was the off-court stuff that was challenging, so.
How bad is Harlingen, Texas?
Harlingen, Texas? What's bad is, like, the weather. Like, I played there one time.
25K event, right?
25K?
Which part of the year is it?
Like or the fall.
Yeah, okay. Fall. Early falling.
But I played, like, it was hot. Like, hot. I played first round qualies, 3 sets. Then I played Noah first round qualies, 3 sets. Second round, I played Kevin Lamb. Won it straight. And then third day, out of nowhere, the wind just blew.
Oh, yeah.
And it got freezing cold.
Texas is crazy cold. Like that.
Like, I swear, like, I'm not making it up. Like, it's hot. Everyone's, like,
literally, like, a 30-degree
difference. From one win. Instantly. One win, it just goes, whoop, and then it's changed. All of a sudden, it's dark, freezing. And now I'm playing matches in a hoodie. I swear. And yeah, the hands are in the pockets. I'm not sitting on changeovers. And then who knows, later in the week, maybe it gets hot again. Like, that's Harlingen. And then there's, like, one side is 3 courts. And one side is, there's a clubhouse and one side is 2 courts. Different paving. Like, this one's, the 2 courts are both green.
Yeah.
And then the other one's, like, green and blue, right?
Yeah.
And so different speeds and, like, they play on both sides, matches on both sides. And qualies is at a different side too.
Makes it better.
Yeah. 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 And then, but, like, I didn't mind it. I always did well there. Like, both times I qualied and won a round. One year I made semis, maybe of doubles or something. You did well there, no? You what? Final?
A solid 1 year, yeah.
Yeah. I actually liked that tournament, so. But.
We had a question from your mother, Auntie G, who invented tennis scoring.
And guess what? We cannot answer that.
It's a mystery, apparently.
So who told us that? Next question.
Main cues, alternates, or 1, 2, 3, whatever.
You know, run the game or what?
Yeah, after.
Oh, so that first. I gotta go for it.
All right.
Are you the moderator or me? What's going on here?
This is just a, what do they call it?
You know, Justin, I'm allowing you.
Socialism.
I'm, okay.
We're socialists.
All right. You like fruits, you said, Evan, right?
Yeah, I like fruits.
Rank these for me. Mango, pineapple, watermelon.
Easy.
All at their peak? In season, right?
Yes.
Mango, pineapple, watermelon. Baby. Watermelon?
Mm-hmm. Is last?
No, it's you first. Crazy. You crazy.
It's first. Mango second, pineapple third.
We got to say a page right now.
I like all of them, though.
You?
Pineapple.
Mango.
See, for me, pineapple is last. It tastes unbelievable. But if you eat pineapple, whatever you eat next, tastes like pineapple. Like, it's too strong. Like, you can't get the taste out of your mouth. And I can't.
Does pineapple belong on pizza?
Not for me.
Yeah.
Not for me.
I can live with it. Next question.
All right. Down break point. Right?
Yeah.
Would you rather be hitting a high backhand?
No.
Coming into the net with a high forehand volley? Like, you're from the baseline coming in, high forehand volley. Right? Or you've just served and the guy chips the returns and you have a low forehand below the net. You have to attack and come in.
High forehand volley.
Rank them.
Easily. Oh, rank them? Okay. High forehand, chip second, high backhand third.
How high? What's the high backhand? Am I like
backing up? You're going to push back. Down break point.
Can I like step and take it early high? Or can,
it's your world. Do what you can do with it.
Maybe. I guess I would take the volley first. I mean, if you're coming and taking a volley, you're already in a good position. Should be in the
back. Do you feel comfortable with that from the baseline running in, balls high in the air?
I mean, how far back can you be hitting up here?
But I'm saying like you crush a back and cross.
Yeah, and they go, well,
you're behind the baseline and you're running in.
I'll still probably
taking that.
Yeah.
Okay.
So you want to
take the volley, take the back end and then the short form, yeah. Okay. What surface are we playing on?
Slow hard.
Yeah, whatever. I'll stick with that.
Yeah, I guess high forehand volley, you're in control of the point. Then forehand and backhand from you got to be last. All right. Best fast food nuggets. McDonald's, Chick-fil-A, or Wendy's?
I don't eat nuggets like that.
You don't like nuggets?
No, I stopped eating them when I was like 8.
Chick-fil-A 1, McDonald's 2, Wendy's 3.
Chick-fil-A has the worst nuggets of the three.
Are you
crazy?
Chick-fil-A has the driest nuggets on earth.
Are you crazy?
Chick-fil-A's nuggets are not good.
Are you a crazy person?
Don't speak about Chick-fil-A like
that. No. I love Chick-fil-A. The tenders are great. The sandwiches are unreal. The nuggets are not good.
Chick-fil-A sponsors.
Chick-fil-A nuggets are the equivalent to the Popeye's biscuit. Make your mouth dry. Not good. Chicken breasts. Boring. Not good. I mean,
so you rather eat plastic than chicken breast?
I'd rather eat McDonald's nuggets than Chick-fil-A nuggets any day of the week.
And where does Wendy fit into this equation for you?
Wendy is ahead of Chick-fil-A too.
Miss Wendy is.
I'm going to go Mickey D's.
Miss Wendy.
The redhead. and then Chick-fil-A.
Chick-fil-A last.
Okay, let's get into the game. Let's grab one.
And in the comments, tell us what you think about those rankings. Play along. Get involved.
All right. So, I'm the moderator now. Because Justin tries to tie me up with these crazy questions. So question number one. This game is first to five. No, sorry. Five questions. Let's see who has the most points at the end of five questions.
Are you live?
No. Don't look at the thing.
Oh, why you got a whiteboard then?
Score.
Oh.
All right. Question one.
I'm actually nervous.
It's a 1v1? If you lose to me.
This is my first time on this side of the whiteboard.
Hey, let me let you guys know, audience. This was difficult to do, to make these questions. So, question number one.
It's really not tough.
Question number one. Can you name the 8 quarterfinalists at Miami?
Oh, my. What?
This guy's tripping. This guy.
Okay, how about this? I'll give the point to whoever gets the most.
This is crazy.
Good question, Jordy.
Thank you.
Awful question.
Don't forget to like. Don't forget to subscribe.
Since you guys went,
comment down below how we're doing here on the solo episode and on the solo episodes, what you want to see.
Now, question: can I name more than 9 players?
No, you can only name eight. Well, what do you think this is?
I'm just gonna name
9 people in an 8 people game,
so you can get as many names you can get out.
That's not fair.
That's the question I'm asking you to clarify.
You have
that
okay?
Can I clarify?
9.
This guy's so annoying.
8.
Oh my god, dude.
How many more you got?
Smokes. This cut is insane.
All right.
We got 4.
Time.
I got 6.
Let's go. Time.
Time.
What do you mean time? All right, here we go. Each person gets 1 more person, right? 1 more person, you write 1 more person. That's fair. That's fair. 10 seconds. You can't look in your phone.
I didn't. Yeah.
No one.
I got 7 names here.
Okay. Go for it, Dustin.
I have Dimitrov.
1.
Marozan.
Hold on. Yeah. 2.
Medvedev.
It's 3.
Zverev.
4.
Rud.
Nope.
Machach.
5.
Sinner.
6.
How many names has he written down?
What are the names you have?
Alcaraz, Sinner, Dimitrov.
I forgot Alcaraz. What is wrong with me?
Casper and Musetti.
Casper and Musetti both lost yesterday.
I got Alcaraz. How can I forget Alcaraz, bro?
Okay, are you ready? Reece, number two.
Crazy. Sorry, Shaq. I shouldn't forget Alcaraz.
Question number two. Another tennis question. Spell the last name of Arthur Rinderknecht.
I didn't spend any time in Europe.
Ready.
Shout out to Arthur. Really?
Yeah.
Okay, let Evan answer.
Yo, Evan, killing me, bro.
Let Evan answer first. Yo.
This looks so wrong.
Spell it.
Spell it.
Is there a K in there?
Spell it out loud now.
Is there a K in there?
Spell it.
So let me know.
Spell it.
Let me know. R-I-N-D-E-R-K-N-E-C-H.
At the same.
Correct. 1 point each.
Oh! That's it. That's a win for me.
Next question.
What? 3-1?
It's 2-1.
2-1.
It's only been two questions.
Okay. It's been a long time.
If you're not cheating, you're not trying. Anyway, next question is, what is the national animal of Scotland?
Bro. I know they got haggis over there.
They have what?
Scotland. Haggis. Is that what they eat? What's haggis?
That? What is that?
Haggis and moonlight. Never heard of that? I think it's like... Doesn't matter.
No, it's rising animal, dog. You're going to get it wrong. You too.
Why are you asking this question?
What kind of...
Scotland, bro. You're going to answer it wrong. The national animal of Scotland is a unicorn.
Okay.
Oh. Can I get half a point?
Absolutely not.
Horse.
Absolutely not.
A goat.
Okay, next question. It's 2-1. Next question.
Question number four.
An electric train is headed east. Where does the smoke go?
There's no smoke. It's electric.
That was the worst question ever.
Well, you're supposed to write it down.
Oh.
All right, next question.
Was that 3-2?
Who is the Laker? No, you don't get that.
We both get it.
Yeah, just give it. You need to
answer
that?
Yes. You just said electric train.
It was obvious that you were trying to do. Trying to set people up.
Yeah. Anyway, what is this? Since you're a LeBron fan too, right? Yeah. What's the Lakers shirt sponsor? Write it down. Don't blurt it out.
The Lakers.
I don't even know what I wrote down.
Lakers have a shirt? I don't know.
I don't even know. It's just...
Five. Four. Three.
Me a life raft here.
Two. One.
I wrote SoFi?
Absolutely not.
I wrote...
There we go. Evan got it. What is Evan got it. It's 2-2. You think I know?
Baby go.
I don't know.
That is true. That is absolutely correct.
What is it?
I believe it's a meal prep, I think.
Too good.
Think. All right. Tiebreaker?
Nope.
Oh, Jody said there's no chance there's going to be a tiebreaker, huh?
It's 2-1. Right?
Yeah, you guys both missed
five questions, though.
Tiebreaker.
We write it down or are we blurting it?
Write it down. Mm-hmm. Where were fortune cookies invented?
I feel like I know this. I don't know.
This is a biased question.
I'm not in the Chinese restaurant industry.
Are we ready?
Chinese, bro.
I'm going to have to write another thing. Find out another question.
You go first, Justin.
Justin, you first.
I put USA.
You also put USA. The answer is Japan.
Crazy.
Bro, what am I going to do now? I didn't prepare for this scenario.
Not so easy, huh?
It's fine. I told you at the beginning. You have no idea how long it took me. All right, we go to a spelling question.
Oh, my. Yeah, you see me now. English is my second language.
All right, you spell it in...
Yeah, it is.
You spell it in Mandarin. Okay, here we go.
I'm going to draw a boat.
Okay. Bro. Spell the word consensuous.
I don't even know what that means. That's consensual? Cool. Consensuous.
Is this podcast appropriate?
This is great, being the quiz master. I feel no pressure. I feel no shame. You know what I mean? Does everyone have the answers locked in?
No. Often.
Consensuous.
Chuous?
I don't know this word, bro.
Spell it.
Consensuous.
Oh my God, this is so wrong.
These guys are melting down.
I'm good, bro.
Spell it.
C-O-N? S-E-N-T?
No.
Okay.
C-O-N-S-E-N.
No. All right, it's a tie. This game is a tie.
Oh, how do you spell it?
It's S-C.
S-C-E-N-T-U-O-U-S?
I-O-U-S.
Yeah, no chance,
I think. I already lost it.
A player's last name. Player's last
name. Okay. This guy is obsessed with winning. All right.
Look at Lionel, the tie.
All right, all right.
Oh, rock, paper, scissors?
Okay. Spell. Rusevori.
Boom!
Spell Rusevori.
Wow, no chance.
Why would we even play this game? You guys are horrid. No.
Are you?
Uh-huh.
You?
Yes.
S?
Yes.
O?
No. That's not it either. It's R-U-U-S-U-V-U-O-R-I.
I had that. I just missed the vote.
Oh, I'm sure you did.
Who was the closest in spelling? I went closest in spelling. How many letters wrong? I have one letter wrong.
And I gotta be worse than me.
I don't think this is a fair.
It's okay. It's okay. We edit this whole game out. So,
all right.
It's all good. We edit the whole thing out. All right. Last topic of the day.
Because Jody wasn't prepared.
He's a horrible quiz master.
Last topic of the day.
He's probably good.
Okay, last topic of the day is rate the slams. If you had to rate the slams in order from 1 to 4 based on atmosphere and prestige.
Atmosphere and prestige.
Jinx.
I don't like how it's set up.
Yeah.
Because different tournaments have different atmospheres.
Okay, go atmosphere first.
Atmosphere, Australian Open, to me, is the best one. I love watching Australian Open for me. Yeah. I would go Australian Open 1. I would go maybe... Aussie Open is 1. Atmosphere for me. I'm just going to give you number 1. I can't rate the other ones.
What?
I can't rate the other ones. Like, what would I say?
It's like when it's 2. Fresh Shrey Wimbledon 4.
I was going to put...
I don't know.
That's atmosphere. And then prestige, it goes
Wimbledon. But there's something about, like, center court Wimbledon. It's not rowdy, but it's like...
But that's like more prestige.
That's prestige, yeah.
But the atmosphere is like, I feel like, sorry, pause, it's like thick, like it's dense. It's like when, like when the... but like...
What?
Like before the matches start and they have the camera out there and you feel the people, it's like... That's a sick atmosphere too. Like to be, I would like to sit. I want to sit in that.
Oh yeah, sick. Yeah.
Yeah, the atmosphere is very cool.
We're not denying that at all.
Like to me, that's cooler than U.S. Open.
Are you mad?
No, I'm serious.
A night match at U.S. Open. The atmosphere at a night match at U.S. Open.
Yeah, that's true.
U.S. Open. Come on now, buddy. Did you just start
for me? That's this year? U.S. Open is my least favorite slam, probably.
Huh?
U.S. Open. Well, Wimbledon US Open are like this for me. They're third and fourth. French, I like second. French Open more than I like the other ones, yeah.
What's sick of... You know what? Never mind.
I just love clay. I turn the TV on, it's orange.
I was about to say that. Yeah, I was about to say that.
And I love clay.
That has nothing
and,
to do
and when I started watching that tennis, the first
to
tournament that I
that
saw...
Nothing to do.
The first tournament that I saw that me want to play tennis was I watched the French Open.
That has...
Juan Carlos Ferreira versus Martin Fourcuc in the final.
That's so amazing. That has nothing...
That's why it's my favorite slam.
Listen to me good. That has nothing to do with the atmosphere, nor the prestige.
Aussie Open has the best atmosphere to me.
Okay, fair.
And then we can go.
We will go.
You want US Open? I say US Open.
Yes.
Then I say Wimbledon, then I say French.
And even then, I can argue the last two. Even then. Because, like, the atmosphere.
First and last?
Because think about it, like the atmosphere on the outer courts at Wimbledon, it's like jam packed, so it's unique. It's like very small spaces, but like at the
French, similar US Open too, you know, they have a million courts out there, and it's a bunch of people everywhere. It's the same thing as Wimbledon.
But the US Open has like they have Armstrong Grandstand, like what is it, Court 13, and they have other stadiums.
They have Court 1. They have other stadiums at Wimbledon too.
Yes, but I'm saying that the spaces in the Wimbledon is tight. They have like a rope and like people there and whatever, and it's not. It doesn't allow for a sick.
To be really, really real with you?
No, no, be real.
Never been to Wimbledon? Never to Australia. I've been to the French and I've been to US Open.
But you've been watching TV, so you can see it.
To me, the most fun looks like Aussie Open.
Mm-hmm.
And my favorite is French Open. I don't even know where the question is anymore, but I'm
see, that's
I'm
your problem. You don't listen.
Bro. Atmosphere?
Evan, talk to me. Evan, talk to me. Your time is over.
I would say...
I don't love US Open, bro. Not a big fan.
I would say Australian Open does look crazy, but I've never experienced it in person.
Hey, say something too.
You have experienced it.
I think...
Give me some.
I think that the least amount of genuine tennis fans is at the US Open. I think at the French Open, you have tennis fans. At Wimbledon, you have tennis fans. At Australian Open, you have tennis fans. I think
that takes away from prestige. Maybe.
I think US Open and but atmosphere, like
yeah,
it's just loud. But I don't think the fans are tennis people. I think it's just they're in New York and there's a tournament going on. That's what I believe is happening at the US Open. It's not
something to do.
Yeah, like people are just getting like you know what I mean. Like they have the girl on the screen doing the chugging the like. US Open is not to me. Is the my. Not the least favorite slam, but I think it has the least amount of tennis fans than the other ones.
The question is not who has the least amount of tennis fans.
And that, for me, makes the atmosphere worse. It's loud, yes, but these people don't know what's going on, feel like.
Look in the camera and tell Addy that. Tell him.
Tell who?
Addy, because this question came from Brian.
That's how I feel. What do you want from me?
All right, go. Talk to me.
All right. I would say, yeah, Australian Open does look really fun. I've heard it's crazy, atmosphere crazy, but I've never experienced it. So I'm going to put US Open.
He played there. He's a baller.
He's a US Open.
Not like that, but I played there. Oh, I also watched, when I was younger, I watched Nadal there, a night match on Arthur Ashe. It's crazy.
Arthur Ashe is just, man, according to Justin.
And cool. Then... Which one's the stadium that comes like a fishbowl? You know what I'm talking about?
I know what you mean. It's,
I watched,
it's not Grandstand or...
Where's the... US Open?
US Open, yeah.
Well, I don't know what year it was. I
think
it was
like Court 13 or something.
Maybe it was the year I played. I don't know. But we watched Ryan Harrison play Kevin Anderson.
Mm-hmm.
Five-setter at night on that court. And the crowd was going insane.
I watched Don Young Wawrinka on that court. Insane.
They're going insane. So US Open 1. I'll put Australian Open 2. Wimbledon 3. French Open 4.
I could live with that. And prestige, maybe not Wimbledon goes to the top because they have a lot of history at pools and all white and fancy strawberry and cream and all that stuff. That's pretty cool.
Who's 2?
2? I would go with maybe for prestige, maybe Roland Garros, and then 3.
Because it got 2 names.
It's in Paris.
I'm about to be.
By the Louvre.
And then I would say 3 is, probably Australia and 4 US Open. Because US Open just seems like a cool slam. It's just like atmosphere to me. Like people coming in, watching. You have celebrities all the time. Like, yeah.
To be clear, I want to play in all the slams.
Let's make this known.
Just clarifying that we love them all.
But the French Open is the favorite one for me.
Yeah. All right, that's about it. Anything else we need to cover before we roll?
That's it, bro.
Thanks again, everybody, for watching.
Bro, no.
Sorry?
What's happening with your life, bro? What are you doing now? What's next?
Me?
Yeah.
Oh, I'm about to hit the jet on Friday.
Where you going?
I'm going over to Monastir.
How long?
2 weeks.
Where to? Who, what, where, when, and why?
Okay, basically, Josh and I agreed pretty much that we're gonna play for the next few months at least together, consistently. So,
can you explain how quick this happened to people? Because I think it's kind of crazy how fast people can decide that I'm gonna go on the other side of the world together.
Yeah, this happened like on Sunday.
Yeah,
from nowhere. From like, yo, Josh, what are you playing? I need someone to play with. I've been scrambling. Like, I've been pretty unlucky.
And today is what?
Today's Wednesday.
Wednesday, yeah.
And this happened Sunday. And it was more like I was supposed to start the season with Evan.
My dog.
Evan got hurt. And then maybe Justin was a backup. Justin got hurt.
I was a backup. That's crazy.
Yeah, Justin was number two, got hurt. And then scrambling back and forth with I play with different partners and that sort of stuff. But no one that I could like consistently play with. And Josh has been Josh is a mad person, by the way. Josh went from the US to Rwanda. Rwanda to Egypt, Egypt back here, and now we're about to go to Tunisia.
He better have the craziest flight miles right now.
Josh is living. So, but yeah, shout out to Josh. We're going to play. Shout out to my partner, Josh. And we're going to play a few in Tunisia and then hopefully come back over here and play some over on this side of the world. So then we'll see how that goes.
Evan?
I should be playing two challengers in Mexico.
When you leave it out?
Supposed to leave Friday.
Mm-hmm.
Some altitude, so.
Mexico City? Yeah. That's like 8,000 feet, no?
Yeah. I said some altitude. Like
that's all the altitude. It doesn't get more altitude than that in the tennis tournament.
The most altitude. And just two there. The next one's on hard after Mexico City. Some altitude. That one's less than Mexico City.
Yeah. Half.
Yeah. And then I'll come back, take a week off.
Good. What about you, Justin? What do you play?
I'm playing the surgeon soon. No. So I'm trying to decide right now between either getting what they call serial injections in my hand or surgery to remove the mass that is creating all the pain in my hand. So I'm talking to physios and doctors over the next few days, making a plan. And hopefully back in the match court, May, June, something like that. But yeah.
What's the mass made of?
They call it a fibroma or reactive tissue. Have you heard of that? Google it.
Yellow fibroma.
You know what I'm saying?
Get some everything.
yeah, but for the meantime, a lot of gym, a lot of fitness. A lot of hip thrusts. Thanks, Ricard. That's all we do.
Every a lot day. Of podcasting.
Hip thrusts. Podcasting.
Not enough podcasting. We lied.
Some meditating, some visualizing, and just, trying to keep the spirits high until I can have a concrete plan. But, even though we didn't get the other two players that we had sort of loosely agreed to.
Three?
Other three that we loosely agreed to interview last week. I actually enjoyed this tonight.
Glad you enjoyed. Let's hope that they enjoyed as much as you did.
I don't actually care that much. Like I enjoyed this.
Tell Evan what the Not Your Country Club guy said, what Nate said to us about that.
I think he's similar to me in the sense that he kind of makes content that he likes to watch. And people like it, they like it. And if they don't, they don't. I'm sure there's a balance with that. Like you can't just make everything for yourself. But I like to think that I'm like a decently normal person. So I think if something is enjoyable, someone else would enjoy it too. So yeah, I had fun tonight.
I think it goes more to like, I don't think he's going to get tired of creating his content because he likes it, he enjoys it, that's what's...
Yeah, like so if we had to come in here and like react to like pop culture or something, I think I would hate that. But that we get to just kind of hang out how we do. Maybe it's a bit more formal. It's a bit more like flowed. We're not on our phones or watching something at the same time, listening to music. But it's fun to just kind of kick it. And yeah, I enjoyed it. So I hope if you're still listening right now, I hope you enjoyed it too. And if you like the string rackets or if you need the string rackets, get you a pro stringer. At the checkout page, use our code CHANGEOVER. You will get $100 off the machine. This machine is great at home, on the road, in the bathroom, in the kitchen.
What about if they wear t-shirts?
If you like to wear t-shirts, and if you like anything that we say on this podcast at all, and you want us to keep making these, we got to pay for editing somehow. And you can buy our merch. We got shirts like that. They got hoodies, not like this. But we got a pink one. We got a white one. We got some pullovers. Maybe come up with some other stuff soon. But go to our link tree in our bio on Instagram. Get you a hoodie. We'll pay for our editing. Reece will be happy with that. And yeah.
Thanks. So guys, don't forget that this episode is sponsored by Super Greens. No, I'm just kidding. We're practicing.
We need some sponsors for sure. Right?
This video is sponsored by Manscaped. No, I'm just kidding.
Yeah, and like, comment, subscribe, engage in the comments. About the ranking stuff, about the game, about whatever you think.
Honestly, like, engagement is going to be huge for us. Like, if you have anything at all to say, even if it's just like, yo, we're still watching. Like,
or this podcast sucks, or whatever you want to say, say it.
People have said it before.
We agree. And we're trying to get better.
But honestly, like I said, if there's a decent amount of you watching this episode up to this point, at least, like, it would be a huge help for us if you make sure that you're subscribed, make sure you send it to people, make sure they're subscribed, like and comment, engage, that sort of stuff. It just helps us with the YouTube algorithm, helps us to grow, because what we've learned is that people actually somewhat enjoy the episodes that we bring, and what we're learning is that we're not getting out there enough, and that maybe has to do with us reminding you that you have to engage, you have to like the videos, you have to share it to people that you think would like it, that sort of stuff. Try to put us on. If you have people you think would be good on the podcast, you can put us in touch. Like, we're easy. We're pretty easily accessible. So,
yeah,
that's how you guys can help us out, too.
It's the same on Instagram stuff, too. Like, if you watch a video and you like it and drop a fire emoji or the stool emoji if you didn't like the video, whatever. But just engage with us.
Thumbs down.
Yeah, anything you want to know, but just engage. But, yeah, we appreciate anybody listening or watching, and yeah, until next time, I guess.
See you guys in the next episode.